to get into what we need to look at. All right, everything's, all the technology is straightened out here. And we start out just by being quiet, because this is the fundamental permission that is being given out here. You have the permission to remain silent. You absolutely do. You have the right to remain silent. You absolutely have the right to remain silent. You don't have to answer any queries at all, any questions. You don't have to explain your silence to anyone, okay? You don't have to respond to requests for interviews. You don't have to respond to the news media. You don't need to, you can remain silent. You don't have to justify your silence. It's based on faith that you have permission from God through Jesus and through the apostles of Jesus to remain silent and still and quiet. Be quiet. You don't have to give answers to anyone. Just be silent. This is your practice. This helps more than any practice to help turn you in the right direction. The world is in full meltdown mode right now, as the Holy Spirit said it would be. So the Holy Spirit has been supremely accurate in this, right to the day, actually. The information that it gave me, I shared with the world, and it's been super accurate in this regard, that there's a full meltdown going on in the world. As I've said before, it's really cosmic corporate culture taking over the planet, and it's taking the form of this corporate Marxism. Now, Marxism is fundamentally an atheistic. It doesn't believe in God. In fact, the basic tenets of Marxism say that religion is the opiate of the masses, that the only way that people can survive in a capitalist society is to believe in religion, that after they die, they'll get some sort of reward for having been so poor and oppressed here in this world. And then what Marxism believes in is that once everything is fair here, you know, fair, whatever they define as fair, then there won't be any more religion. People just naturally say, oh, yeah, that's just a fairy tale. I just believe in it to give myself some sort of false hope, but don't need it now. So this is the basic tenets of Marxism. It's completely false, of course, because they make a straw man out of religion, out of God, and then attack the straw man and tear the straw man apart and say, see, there's nothing there. This is typical. Now, you see, here's the part we need to clarify. It is somewhat true that religion has been the opiate of the masses, okay. But that in no way means that God doesn't exist at all. It doesn't mean that at all. We can form a concept of God, all right, which was what many have done, to help them get by and continue in this dream of arrogance, which we call existence. But just because people are turning their attention onto a concept of God, and that concept of God is false, doesn't mean that true God therefore doesn't exist. And this is the ridiculous straw man logical fallacy that Marxists engage in. Even a child could see through this. It's so stupid. And yet there are many who don't see through this at all, and base their whole religion of Marxism upon this. And Marxism is a religion. There's no question about it. You might say right now, Marxism is the opiate of the masses. Both the Pope and the President are naked Marxists, actually. And the global, overall global campaign is to Marxism and consumerism and corporate. See, corporations want to be worshipped as the bringers of fairness and equality. If everyone gets equal material goods, and that will bring this millennial humanistic paradise to this world. And of course, they couldn't be more mistaken. But this is what's going on in the world. And if anyone dares to raise their voice and threaten this, you know, lunacy, you know, they become rabid towards them, which is what Donald Trump is finding out right now. Is the naked rabidness, you know, comes to the surface. And of course, Trump is a capitalist, and they, you know, hate capitalism. Now, I'm not a friend of capitalism, neither am I a friend of Marxism. Okay, I'm a friend of salvation. And this is, neither one recognizes salvation, actually. Neither one. Neither one. So we're not choosing sides here. We're saying that there's a third option. All right, there's a third option, which is salvation. And you begin to tune into salvation through quietude, through still mind, still body. And I call it walking together in the wow, because when you hear truth, it shocks you. You say, wow, I'm not as trapped as I thought I was. This is fantastic. I thought I'd never hear this. You know, really, we're in a situation where we are so desperate that we really are almost convinced that we'll never get free. We're almost convinced. We're about as convinced as convincement can be, because how can you can be totally convinced of a lie if you yourself are truth? You cannot be actually totally convinced in a lie. You can only believe in time and the play of the lie in time, but you can never be actually convinced, totally convinced. Impossible. So we're almost as far convinced as we can be that we're trapped and we've lost ourselves and all this. So just imagine it dawning upon you, and a little bit dawns upon you, that you're not trapped, that you are free. Nothing has happened to what you are. The news is so great that it's just overwhelming. So you have to practice receiving this good news, the gospel. Now, much of what Jesus did when he was here was actually give us hints about right practice. He coded the right practice in the various parables and the allegories and his life, the drama and everything. It was a way of pointing us to right practice. Like the Last Supper was really about right practice. And now he's come back and he's explaining it to those who are capable. He's explaining it very directly. So I can pass that on to you. I'm just going to bump this down a little bit, if that's possible. You can start practicing, and we call this practicing walking together in the wow, or full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, where the good news is so extreme that you need to just sit here, because you're momentarily just stunned by it. You mean I can be free of both Marxism and capitalism in this terrible struggle, and I can be free of this hideous realm of impermanence and death and sickness, and I can be free? You mean this is all a dream? Yes. You know, I can be free? Yes. The news is so great, there's no way to express it. It's off the charts. So what we say is, don't even try to express it. Just sit quietly. Sitting quietly is not meaning nothing's happening. It's meaning that you're so amazed at the truth you're seeing, that trying to express it is folly. It's damning with vain expression. Just be quiet. It's better to be quiet than to stumble around trying to express just how great the good news is. So the only way you're really going to hear the good news is by training to be quiet and feel that you have the right to be quiet. Because by being quiet, you're saying, telling yourself, there is something worth hearing that is such a great news that I have to just be quiet. It's so wonderful. That's what you're saying. You have faith in that. And of course, the world doesn't want you to have faith in that at all. It says, I want you to be constantly active and so, because that proves that there's nothing so great. So no news so great that it could shock you. You don't need to be skilled in quietude at all. This is, there's nothing, what for what? Get out there and redistribute the wealth and make sure everybody has all the same, and then we'll all forget about religion, we'll all forget about God, realize that was a fairy tale, and we'll all live happily ever after. This is what the world is saying. Now I can speak up because I don't have any money. I don't have any wealth to protect. What can I be fired from, basically? How can my wealth be attacked? You see, all those kind of... nothing to lose. Really nothing to lose. And of course, my boss, being Jesus, isn't going to fire me for speaking the truth. You know, I'm sure there'd be a petition of billions of people petitioning Jesus, hey, tell this guy to shut up. We don't like what he's saying. And Jesus is going to just not even look at the petition. Jesus doesn't look at petitions. Be assured of that. Now, the Pope's coming to the Americas in late September. I'll be here, you know, I think through September 27th or something. He's coming to Cuba first, spending about as much time in Cuba as he is in the United States. The ex-Pope, Pope Emeritus Francis. And, well, Cuba is about 60% Catholic. It's not outlawed there, but it is heavily, you know, tied into Marxism there. So he's spending as much time in Marxist Catholicism, liberation theology, and Marxist theology as he is in the United States, where there's many conservative Catholics. That's very interesting. So the Marxist movement is have taken off the gloves. The veil has been drawn aside, and the apocalypse is on. Apocalypse means lifting of the veil. The veils have been lifted. Oh my gosh, we don't have a pope. We have a Marxist. We don't have a president. We have a Marxist, and they actually believe in global Marxism. And that religion will be automatically phased out once the goals of Marxism are arrived at. And this is what they actually believe. And we realize that the media are just also naked Marxists, especially mainstream media. Corporate media is simply are naked Marxists. They've come out of the closet too. So all these Marxists are coming out of the closet. They're being outed, which is good. Now we get to see, you know, it's the apocalypse, lifting of the veil, where we are in the apocalyptic, we're in apocalyptic times right now. So people have a right to simply make no comment, to be remain quiet and still, and prepare for great good news. The world will never have the news that you're looking for, that anyone's looking for. Right? But the great good news is discovering within yourself that you have authority over this dream. Okay, and you can shift universes, actually. You can shift universes. And you can insist that you know the will, the final judgment of God upon you right this instant. You have the right and capacity that cannot be taken away to do this. You can insist that God let you know right now, this instant, what God's final judgment is upon you. That's it. So this permission to remain silent is the key. And most people, they're playing real tough, you know, like, I don't need anyone to give me permission. If I want to do it, I can do it. But the fact is, they're not doing it. And if ever there was a time, a situation in this world where being quiet and silent and still was absolutely called for, it's right now. And nobody's doing it. Okay, so this whole braggadocio, you know, it's just a bluff. It's a bluff of people who are very frightened. They say, well, I'd like to do it, but I don't have permission. Who's going to give me permission to do it? So I give, part of my role is to give everyone permission to do this here. I give myself permission. I give you permission. I give everyone permission. So I'm still working through the issues myself. Had some in the dream last night that some kind of very interesting had to do with being handicapped or handicap restrictions, and I was sort of basically seeing through it. There's the idea of being sick, of being infirm, of getting old. All this stuff is part of a attempt to make a deal with God, actually, to make a deal to, you know, to attain leniency or something, along with trying to prove that arrogance is right, arrogance is true, that we did deviate from reality, rather than just have a dream of deviating from reality. See, we're having a dream of deviating from reality, and we're insisting that it's not a dream, it's actually a real deviation from reality. Nice little breeze today. It's not nearly as warm today. There's some tropical air going to be coming in here next couple days. It's actually already starting. But we have to get this rolling, and I'm doing the best I can, trying to speed it up. Still getting hit with conundrums, you know, dreams that give to rise, you know, the underlying restrictions we put on ourselves. And I'm suffering from some troubles in structurally in the body now, and I'm trying to get to the point where I realize I don't need that. I don't need that. I just drop it. Just don't need it at all. I don't have to establish a handicap to then claim special status, try to claim some special status from God. Don't need it. So I'm trying to work this through. This will help me be more effective when I work this through. What people really want is just to be quiet and feel they don't have to answer to anyone. They don't have to justify this silence. They don't have to rationalize this silence. Don't have to explain it. Just you have full permission just to be silent. And you don't have to answer to anyone about that silence. And when we take this step back, then the light of God steps forward. And the fundamental assertion now we've gotten to is, I insist that you let me know what your final judgment is upon me. Final, permanent, binding judgment upon me. I insist on you letting me know that right now, this instant. And then sit quietly as you repeat that. Again, I insist this very instant that God reveal to me his final judgment upon me. I after which there is no more judgment. It's final. So I insist that God's final judgment be revealed to me right now. I insist that God's final judgment be revealed to me right now. We don't have to explain at all. You're free from the need of explanation, because you will, the truth reveals itself within you, and the wow reaction, it's more than can be explained. Explanation again always damns it with faint praise, you know. We have to be very careful about explanation. It has to be done in the right context. Like these videos, we put in the context of full stop and the wow. And if it gets too strong, we're right there with full stop and the wow. People might ask you, well, what right do you have to be silent? You have to explain to yourself. We need to question you. No, just say, I have the right through authority of Jesus, which is the authority of God. And that's it. Don't need any more authority than that. I mean, there's no authority that can trump that. So I insist that God pass final judgment on me this very instant. I insist that God pass final judgment on me this very instant. That's all we ask for, okay? We don't need to ask for worldly success at all. We're not concerned about that anymore. All we ask for is God, for God to pass final judgment on us this very instant. Very sleepy. Middle of the day. It's really heating up now. I can feel it. That's okay. Just remain with the, remain quiet and say, I insist that God pass final judgment on me right this instant. I insist that I know God's final judgment upon me this very instant. I insist that I know God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Now, just granting yourself the right to sit in silence is going to be super important going forward. I mean, the turmoil is just going, we're just getting started here. And people are just starting to wake up and say, oh my gosh, we were fooled again, weren't we? Yeah. Now, we can say to this world, hey world, you don't have any say over my destiny whatsoever. You have no control over my destiny. Specifically, we could say the millennials. Hey, millennials, you have no control over my destiny whatsoever. Hey, techies, you have no control over my destiny whatsoever. These are the ones who feel once this corporate Marxism of control, command and control is put into place, they'll control everyone's destiny. And they'll get rid of religion, get rid of God. And all we need is hedonism, materialistic hedonism. Turn this planet into a paradise and everybody will be so happy here. Adam and Eve again, you know. Well, they don't control my destiny whatsoever. They have no say in my destiny, none. Because my destiny is with the final judgment of God upon me. That's my destiny. Because final. And God has actually already given out the final judgment. Did it concurrently with the beginning of the detour into arrogance, which is a dream, the dream of arrogance. That the final judgment was given right then, at the very beginning. And it remained that way till the very end of this dream of arrogance. So it's just waiting there for us. There's nothing we have to do to earn it at all. We can't lose it either. It's always there waiting for us. Waiting to be accepted. So, now this issue of being handicapped, we're all some constrained by, you know, something. We don't have to be, actually. There's something about, like, I realize I don't need to have any handicap. My handicap is zero, permanently zero. We're trying to prove that we should, God should go easy on us, not punish us too bad. And so, oh God, I've got this infirmity. Look, I'm trying to. I saw in the dream it was something about playing golf and trying to get a golf handicap. And I got to my ball that was had gone far to the left, so to speak. Talking about the world, I think. It's symbolizing in some way. And then I got up to hit it. And I said, well, I think I can reach the green from here. I got to take like a 3-wood or a hybrid and hit it. And the ball started moving on its own. I didn't hit it. It just started moving. And it rolled down the hillside and just kept rolling and rolling and rolling and rolling and rolling. And so I couldn't get to it and hit it, you know, get it back on the green. It's amazing. And then I saw somebody else getting ready to hit the ball, and it started rolling. And then they said, they hit the ball. I said, no, you didn't. I was watching you. The ball started rolling on its own. So there's something I still have to clarify. Something about my handicap is zero. I have zero handicap. I don't have to establish my handicap anymore. It's permanently established. So I don't have to play the game anymore. The idea, like in golf, your handicap, you have to keep playing and keep noting what your score is. And so your handicap is always in flux, depending on, like, you know, how you've been playing recently. But if you have a handicap of permanent zero, you don't need to keep playing, do you? The idea with a handicap is you can compete against others in tournaments and factor in their handicaps. It's like a level playing field. But God is not a level playing field. God is completely unfair to arrogance. It's not a level playing field where arrogance and truth can play together. So we don't need to. And our golf, our game is not ever changing. So our handicap is permanently set at zero. We have zero handicap. Now, I've always felt that I've brought illness upon myself, like a handicap, to try to level the playing field with others. So I keep my clarity, but I can't go around and express it to anybody. I'm too sick to do so. And the ego says, well, see, this helps level the playing field. Other people, they can't compete with you. It's not fair. So we have to give you a handicap. And so I feel that my infirmity and everything I've suffered in my life is just, I imposed it, I accepted this imposition upon myself like a handicap, excuse me, like a handicap to keep it fair. So nobody knows what I'm saying, and I can't really talk to anybody about it. I can't pursue it because I don't have the energy or the health or anything. But I need to now, you know, shed that handicap so I can help get around and have the energy to do it. So I got a zero handicap, and it's a permanent zero handicap, so I don't need to keep playing or do anything or even keep score anymore. It's a permanent handicap. I'm a permanent zero handicapper. No handicaps. And this way I can lift the infirmity. It's all in the mind anyway. All the infirmities in the mind. And so I can just lift this, let it set it down. So I don't need to suffer from any handicap at all. I already said it. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness. Absolutely. I am that perfect unfairness. So may perfect unfairness reign always. Meaning it's perfectly unfair to arrogance. Arrogance has no say in reality. And arrogance says, well, that's unfair. Absolutely, it's unfair. It's perfectly unfair. Perfectly unfair. We celebrate that perfect unfairness. And there may need to be a, well, we'll go one step at a time. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I'm working on something also. You can see the world and the attitude it has. Wow. The hate that the world is full of, and the insecurity and fear, and the desperate belief that Marxism is the answer that will satisfy everyone. And they don't see any other answer. Having abandoned religion, they think Marxism is the only answer there is. So they're just completely tone deaf to hearing anything about that Marxism isn't it. They think that God was just a straw man, and that straw man has been destroyed, and there isn't any God. So the only hope they have is this, you know, this they call it fairness. Be fair to arrogance. Yeah, but arrogance is his own worst enemy. So You know, it can arrogance can never be fair to arrogance. How can it be fair? It's nothing. It's a lie. How can lies be fair? Lies say the only way to be fair to lies is to make them true, you know, but they can't be made true. So there is this virulent plague of Marxism in the world. And the idea is to flood all countries with third world peoples who tend to resonate with the Marxist ideology of, hey, yeah, they have more than we do. If we had what they have, we'll be happy. Of course, they overlook the fact that those who have all the material abundance aren't happy at all. A lot of them are very depressed. And they realize that's not the answer. But they don't, third world people don't realize that yet. So the plan is to flood all the world, advanced countries, with third world people, third world radicals, and shift the political balance over to the third world radicals, which is what's going on in the United States. And anything that stands in the way of that, you know, is standing in the way of their planned utopia. That's why when Trump says, hey, look, let's have border security, build a wall, they just freak out. They completely freak out. That would interfere with their plans to keep flooding the United States with, you know, illegal immigrants with third world peoples who easily resonate with the Marxist message. Hey, the government will just give you everything. We'll take from the rich, give to the poor, and you'll have everything that they have, and then you'll be happy. And of course, if you come up from a dirt poor third world country where, you know, sickness and death and everything, it's like, wow, yeah, of course, material paradise, that must be the answer. They're very vulnerable to this message, whereas the sophisticated intellectuals of prosperous countries, having already experienced prosperity and all sorts of privilege, they realize that's not it. That's not it at all. That's not the answer at all. And so they don't resonate with the Marxist message. They realize there's something wrong. This is a dream of arrogance we're having here. We're trying to change reality. And that what we really are is inherently perfect. And by trying to get better, we're denying inherent perfection, you see. But there are not enough of those people in the world to halt the rampage of Marxism in the world. There are not enough of those people at all. But those who are that way, they need to recognize they have the permission to be quiet. Now, for instance, the Catholics, they realize they don't have a pope. And they need to go back to apostolic authority, genuine apostolic authority. And I represent that and give all Catholics permission to keep practice quiet and stillness. And don't need to listen to that Pope Emeritus anymore. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Listen to Jesus Christ. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Listen to the truth within you. And the truth will dawn upon you. And you have to be able to remain quiet when it dawns upon you. Otherwise, you're going to act it out and you'll feel like you're losing control of your life. You have to let the shock wear off. The news is so great, you have to let the shock wear off. That I already have God's final judgment upon me. What could be better news than that? You don't have to wait a second more. Nobody has to wait a second more. And certainly, it's completely within your power to not have to wait at all. And of course, God's final judgment upon us is that we're absolutely perfect. And we can never stray one iota from this perfection. This is God's final judgment. And we have access to that right now. And yet, we have to practice absorbing the shock of this great good news. Well, we can't do that running around trying to fix the world. Okay, the fix the world, you know, set this world down. You don't need this world. Shift universes. That's what the world wants us to do. Let it go. So we say, world, we don't need you. And let it dissolve into light. You know, this is what the world really wants. This is what we really want. So I don't know what I'm going to do, what Jesus exactly. I'm gradually trying to get myself up to speed. But the Catholics and Christians, now of course Christians, like referring to Protestants, non-Catholic Christians, they get their marching orders from the Bible. But keep in mind that God's final judgment supersedes the Bible. Okay, this is what's more important. So the fact is that God's final judgment is here, is here with us right now. The kingdom of heaven is at hand, Jesus always said. Kingdom of heaven is at hand. Well, how do you get into the kingdom of heaven without God's final judgment, right? But Jesus said 2,000 years ago, the kingdom, repent, 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 the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's the nearest thing there is. So that must have meant that the final judgment's already been made. So at this point, don't you just need to be still and quiet and so you can receive the final judgment? So again, to non-Catholic Christians, I say, you have permission to be quiet, to be still, to be quiet. You don't have to read anything anymore. You have to insist that you be made aware of God's final judgment upon you this very instant. This is the key to salvation, actually. Okay. I'll see if I'm going to move around a little bit right now or not. I might have to. Let me see. Maybe not. We will see. Apparently not, yeah. Okay. So everybody has the right to be liberated into silence right now. This is the real liberation. Don't fall for this phony battle between Marxism and capitalism. That's a phony, distractive battle that's going on. Neither one of those has a clue about salvation, actually. They don't. They don't have a clue. They're absolutely clueless. Real religion tells you that God's final judgment is available to you right this instant. It's already been made right this instant, and you can have the right to be made aware of it and be governed by that. So true governance for all of us is actually God's final judgment upon us. That's true, our true governance. That is our true governance. And of course, Marxism and capitalism are both frantically trying to put their own brand of governance, in the world. It was capitalism for a while, and now Marxism has been making inroads, and now it's finally winning the day around the world. And they're putting their style of governance in, but we have the right to install our own governance over us, which is the judgment, the final judgment of God upon us. That then becomes our true governance. And of course, God will say, you're perfectly free. You don't have to stay in this universe. What are you talking about? You don't have to keep dreaming of a universe. If you want to, you can dream of another universe that reminds you of reality a lot better than this one does. But you're free, but the grace of God will give us governance that is just right for us to help us prepare to accept that time is never going to start. It's never going to start. That arrogance can never be proved true. Okay, can never be. We'll get prepared for that. So the real governance that we're seeking is the governance of the judgment of final judgment of God upon us. That is absolutely the governance. So we don't need to trouble ourselves with the events of the world, with the struggle that's going on. We certainly don't have to be completely stupid about it. I mean, we can realize, yeah, okay, the cat's out of the bag. There is this just a full-on attempt to crush laissez-faire, unrestricted capitalism, where, you know, individualism, where we try to be self-governing, self-made people, and not beholden to a government too much. There's an attempt to absolutely crush that. Now, Donald Trump represents that, and so they're out to absolutely crush him. So we can be aware that this is going on, but that doesn't have anything to do with us, because we're seeing a different governance altogether than either the capitalists or the Marxists want. You see, the Marxists hate religion because they think that enables capitalism to flourish, and to a certain extent that is true. But that's not true religion that they're talking about. They're attacking the straw man religion. Real religion, again, starts and finishes with the good news, the gospel, which is God's final judgment is available to us right this instant. God's final judgment upon us is the same as upon all forever. It's one judgment for all. And it was made concurrently with the instant we detoured into dream of arrogance. So real religion is based on this. It's not based on trying to please God. It's not based on sacrificing to God, trying to please God, worrying about punishment, having a legal team, trying to arrange a deal with God where you don't have to pay so much debt to God and you don't be punished so badly and all this. That's not real religion. That's something that capitalism invented, actually. That is, see, Marxism has some half-truths, you see, to it. Both do. Capitalism points out the fallacy of Marxism. Marxism points out the fallacy of capitalism. But they're only dealing with straw men. That's it. They're tearing each other's straw men to pieces and saying, look, you know, neither one is right. They're both completely bogus. Again, real religion starts and ends with the fact, with accepting the fact that God's final judgment is available to me right now, this instant. And there's absolutely nothing I need to do. One way or another, this judgment was made concurrently with the very instant that this dream began. And it hasn't changed. It'll never change in the slightest bit. So there's nothing that I've ever done that has affected it in any way. Nothing I can ever do that will affect it in any way. So what's the use of delaying? It's ridiculous, isn't it? Delay serves absolutely no purpose whatsoever. None. Zero. This is real religion. And real religion is so tremendous. Then the good news is immeasurable. Therefore, we have to practice the silence, the stillness, this full stop and the woundness. You must have discipline. And now, some vestige of this it has been in Christianity. There's some of that has been there. You must practice discipline. The Eucharist is actually was Jesus codifying a spiritual practice, actually, because he said, "My teaching is the bread of life." Okay, not his physical body or physical blood at all. His teaching, the bread of life. He who eats of this bread, blood shall have eternal life. So the Eucharist is given out as a practice. They do this. The Eucharist represents the unleavened truth that God's final judgment is here upon us right now, there's nothing we need to do about it. It represents the great good news. And then the wine, which is taken after the Eucharist, represents the wow reaction to this great good news. Okay. So the Mass actually is intended to symbolize right spiritual practice, except they took it literally. The literalism crept into it. And they take it that they're actually eating the actual body and the flesh and the blood of Jesus. Where, but he said very clearly his flesh and blood was really his spiritual teachings, his words and his teaching are, that's his flesh and blood. He said that the flesh profiteth nothing. The flesh profiteth nothing whatsoever. So, you know, there's nothing inherently wrong with the Eucharist if you understand what its purpose is. The Eucharist also symbolizes full stop and the wow. I mean, the idea that the priest gives you the homily, which is supposed to deliver spiritual truth to you, then you take the wafer and you say, okay, full stop and the wow. And then the wine represents the realization that there's this, you know, buzzing reverberation going on in you, okay, that you have to sit quietly and allow it to dissipate. So it indicates the key spiritual practice, which is full stop in the wow. First you get the message. Then you have to make the commitment. The Eucharistic waiver is the commitment, the will to full stop in the wow. And then you feel the wine is the wowness. So the waiver represents preemptive action, okay? And what this practice is all about is when you make the big breakthrough and you get a glimpse, and then you know that even though you're not feeling the wow right now, you're in shock. And so don't wait for the wow to hit you. Preemptively say, okay, I'm going to take refuge in neutrality. The unleavened Passover bread. Passover bread meaning when the Jews fled, they didn't have time to put any yeast in their bread. So that means you gotta go fast, preemptively. Hey, it's time to leave. Don't wait to put leaven in your bread. So when you have the spiritual breakthrough, don't wait until the full intensity of the wow hits you. And then try to decide what to do. You make a preemptive decision. I am going into neutrality right now. I am going into full stop in the wow right now. This is the Eucharist. And then the wine represents then the full onslaught of the wow. You know, and then you say, go. Oh. And you're able to manage the shock of it because you took a preemptive step. Okay, you said, I can't wait around. I got to do it right now. So Jesus was really giving us the key spiritual practice, the key spiritual practice. And I've been able to clarify this now as what it really is this full stop in the wow, walking together in the wow, full stop in the wow, three-part practice. Assertions, you assert the truth, you glimpse the truth, you have breakthroughs, preemptively full stop in the wow. And then as that wow starts wearing off a little bit, you go back to a little bit of consideration again, moving back, flipping the script back towards assertions. It's a loop. It's a circular loop like this. And it can also go from flipping the script, if the wow might come up really fast, and phew, right back into full stop on the wow like this. And then flipping the script might go real quickly and you're back to assertions and then back to full stop on the wow. It's like a circular loop like this. And This is the effective spiritual practice that Jesus gave us through the Last Supper and the Mass of the Eucharist, actually. But the transubstantialists from Egypt distorted this. They were into white gold in Egypt, transmuting the atoms of gold and then eating those, putting those atoms into a wafer and then eating those wafers and what monoamic gold or something where the, you know, they changed the atomic structure of gold through their various technologies that they had. And they felt that gradually you eat this gold in this, it's a powder, like a white powder, I think, in the wafers, and that you gradually change the atomic structure of your body that way, and that was the way to salvation. So this Egyptian religion contaminated the Roman Catholicism, contaminated Christianity, by claiming that the priests have the power to put the body and the flesh of Christ into the communion wafer, which then makes spiritualizes it, as if, you know, somehow it has some capacity now to change your subatomic structure, actually is what they really are getting at. That's called transubstantiation. And this is not what Jesus taught at all. Absolutely not. And there's a lot of that. Keep in mind, Egypt was around for a long time. Keep in mind that Egypt and Rome basically became blended into one another. And that the ancient teachings of Jesus were very well known in Roman religion. And, for instance, the Madonna and Child was an Egyptian religious symbol. Okay, it was all over the Roman Empire. And when Christianity finally became the religion of the Roman Empire, they basically got rid of all of the icons of pagan religion, Egypt religion, except the Madonna and Child, because people were so attached to it. It was the most important icon, and it was everywhere. And they just decided, well, we'll just include this in Christianity, and now we'll include the Madonna and Child motif into Christianity. But originally, there was no such Madonna and Child motif whatsoever in Christianity. So the church came like a hybrid, but there were still, you know, teachings that were carrying the original Christianity too. So, but it's gotten kind of jumbled up. But it's pretty easy just to see the Eucharist as for what it is. It's actually pointing to right spiritual practice, which is, of course, what Jesus said. His word and his teachings are the manna from heaven, the bread of life that will give us eternal life. He who eats of this bread shall have eternal life. Meaning, he who commits himself to this practice, which is really full stop in the wow practice, shall gain eternal life. By what? By accepting God's final judgment upon them right now. And of course, what is God's final judgment upon us? That we are perfect eternal life. It's obvious how simple it is, actually, when you get to it. A little muggy now. It's hot and muggy because this cloud cover. So Jesus certainly doesn't want Catholics, let's put it this way, to become Marxists, okay? And also, at least from what I see, there's no need for Catholics to become Protestants or Protestants to become Catholics, or Roman Catholics could be Eastern Orthodox Catholics or whatever. Everybody can just stay within their niche, okay, wherever they are. They just have to do right spiritual practice, which the cornerstone of that is full stop on the wow, practicing that. Because it's the only way you can really absorb the great good news that you already are eternal life right here, right now. You can accept God's final judgment this instant. You don't have to wait till you die. And dying doesn't guarantee that you accept God's final judgment at all. You don't receive God's final judgment upon your death of the body here, not at all. God's final judgment began concurrently with the instant of this dream of arrogance began. And it is that God's judgment is that we are eternal spirit, exactly as God created us to be. And we've never deviated from that in the slightest bit. So how can death bring, you know, have anything to do with that, actually? Nothing to do with it at all. So death does not guarantee that you're going to accept God's final judgment this instant. You might postpone it. Still, you say, well, I'm not quite ready for it yet. And so you're still in the dream of arrogance. Keep in mind that death is the dream of arrogance. In fact, this whole dream of arrogance is a dream of death. So dying doesn't free you from the dream of arrogance, actually. The death of the body doesn't free you from the dream of arrogance. Now, it can, it is possible, just as it's possible as instant, that you can use that instant to accept God's final judgment upon you. That is possible. Or you can have like a near-death experience in this world, and you can use that. A near-death experience often is an expression of you saying, you know what, I really don't need this world. And I'd rather just have God's final judgment right now. That is possible. It is any instant we can do it. It's not necessary. It's not necessary at all. But it's also, you know, doesn't preclude it in any way. There's nothing that we can experience here that actually precludes us from insisting on experiencing God's final judgment upon us right this instant. Nothing precludes it at all. We were free to any instant, no matter what our situation happens to be. Rich or poor, older, young, you know, sick or well, or, you know, alive or dead, whatever. Nothing precludes it. Nothing precludes it at all. But the fact is, you don't have to wait an instant, and nothing has to happen to you. No circumstances have to arise. No situations have to arise for you whatsoever. Nothing in particular has to happen at all. Nothing in particular has to happen at all. This is very important. Nothing in particular has to happen at all. Pragmatically, though, we better be skilled in full stop in the wowness, okay? Because the realization that nothing in particular needs to happen at all is such a stunning recognition. I'm having that right now. Because that brings the immediacy of the now, doesn't it? Nothing whatsoever has to happen. Nothing in particular has to happen whatsoever. Not one shred of anything in particular need happen to accept God's final judgment right this instant. To be aware of it this very instant. Nothing particular needs to happen. This is the real gospel. This is the bread of life that Jesus is talking about. Now, we just stay with this full stop in the wow. Keep in mind that the Marxism, they say that the end justifies the means. So they don't care in the slightest bit whatever your critique of their means are at all. That's why they turn a completely deaf ear to whatever anyone says. The criticism bounces off their back like water off a duck's back. There's just no response, no, doesn't register at all. Doesn't matter what they do. Doesn't matter what they do. What the means are, they say, whatever the means are, we don't have to discern or judge or be aware. It doesn't matter. As long as the end is reached, then that will justify all the means. Period. So they're intractable, you know. Some people say it's like a severe mental illness. It's that nothing registers with them. That's why imprisoning people, killing people, is nothing to them. Nothing. They say, well, it doesn't matter, because once we reach our objective, then everything will be fair. And everybody will forgive us. And we'll say, wow, you're our saviors, so we don't care what you did. So it is useless to waste your time arguing with Marxists. Completely useless. And capitalists will at least pretend to be fair and open-minded and interested, but that only goes so far, actually. It really doesn't resolve anything. Both are quite stubborn and hard-headed. So with the Marxists, you can point out, hey, what you're doing is brutally unfair. Not right. And they'll kind of say, well, yeah, well, it's fair. What they really mean is, once we succeed, everything will be fair. So, you know, put up with the suffering for now. But you know, soon everything will be perfectly fair for you. Don't worry. So it's a waste of time tilting at windmills with these folks. Absolute waste of time. You cannot change their mind at all. That's why the Holy Spirit said, I cannot comment on anything on the internet. I cannot make any comments, which I don't. I don't comment. Because it's completely futile and useless. It's like you're dealing with just like completely terminal trolls, you know. They're just terminal trolls. And they're just there to waste your time and effort. That's all. Many of the posters are actually professional posters online. That's their job. That's what they do. And they just espouse, you know, either Marxism or capitalism. They just espouse that. That's it. Either getting paid for it, or they feel that they'll get a privileged place in Marxism once, you know, once it gains complete control, that they'll, you know, be heroes of the revolution. But certainly, it's likely a lot of them are getting paid. There's also, you know, China does a lot of that too on issues that are important to it. It floods the comment section with, you know, professional trolls. And both sides, capitalism, religion, and Marxism, religion, have nowhere else to go. So, you know, they feel that it's that or nothing. It's that or nothing. So they'll go down fighting. One or the other will go down fighting. And some notes about the world. We're not stupid about it. This Jade Helm operation of a military massive seven-state operation in southwest United States. So why is it being done there? Well, some are saying it's because an asteroid's going to hit in the Atlantic Ocean, and there's going to be just massive refugees fleeing into the southwest from Mexico. I mean, the asteroid hits near Puerto Rico, is going to cause a massive tsunami in the east coast of the United States and Gulf of Mexico. And there may be just, you know, be people flooding into those areas, and they may have to call martial law in those areas. This is a theory. Keep in mind that the Pope is going to be in the United States on, I think, September 25th, the date that they some claim an asteroid is going to strike. So a lot of people are saying, hey, this Jade Helm military operation is really a preparation for installing martial law in the United States. And if you have a massive refugee situation, you know, it makes sense to install martial law, doesn't it? I mean, that's one thing that people are forgetting. I mean, if you have, you know, 100 million people suddenly flood into your cities and are breaking into your supermarkets and taking all the food and breaking into your homes and, you know, getting, stealing whatever they want, you know, you'd want martial law at that point, wouldn't you? You absolutely would. Or two. So, it's interesting. Vaccination thing, too, is very interesting in California. All public, private, and day schools must vaccinate their children. That must accept all vaccination that state decrees are necessary. No recourse whatsoever. And all these people are talking about parents saying, great, great, finally we've won. And now my child can go to school safely and not get sick from these idiots who refused vaccination. I say, wait a minute. So what's wrong with this reasoning? And this is like so crazy that I don't have to explain it to you, but it's so obvious, it's bizarre. So the parents who are totally in favor of vaccination obviously get their children fully vaccinated, right? Absolutely. They wouldn't think of not doing this. So they're sending their vaccinated children to school, right? And yet here they are frantically frightened that some kid might come to school who's not been vaccinated and might bring like the measles to the school. And they say, well, that endangers my child. No, wait a minute. Your child's obviously already been vaccinated for measles, so what are you worrying about? They can't get measles. They're safe, right? You believe in the effectiveness of vaccines, right? So what in the world are you so scared about? It's bizarre. This just points out how bizarre our minds have become. Attacking straw man, etc., etc., etc. Doesn't make any sense at all what the arguments are. If you have 99% of the people are vaccinated and 1% don't want to be, how does that threaten the 99% who are vaccinated? It only would threaten the 1% that aren't. And that's their right, is it not? So, this is Marxism gone crazy, obviously. As this points out the absurdity of it. That somehow they're frantically insisting that in order for their children to be safe, everybody has to be vaccinated. Even if their children are already vaccinated, that's not good enough. That should provide safety, right? So why are you worried about the ones who aren't vaccinated? It completely doesn't add up at all. And of course, nobody's pointing this out. And for me, it was just obvious. I said, what in the world are they talking about? So that's a little humor there. I mean, that is just hilarious. Just hilarious to see how a collective consciousness can act in a way which is absurd. It's the people who haven't been vaccinated that are worried about catching something. Those who already have been vaccinated, if the vaccination is effective, what are they worried about? Shouldn't bother them at all. Actually, vaccination in a lot of people's minds is a status symbol. Just like getting chipped will be a status symbol. It's like, wow, you're not chipped yet? You know, you're out of style. This is a stylish thing. This is status. Anyone's not chipped is low information people, you know. So. So, and also the paranoia about Jade Helm, you know, again, is kind of stupid. A lot of conservatives are really worried about it for various reasons, but from the standpoint of an asteroid and refugees, again, martial law. You'd want help. Now, of course, people with guns say, we don't need any help. We'll take care of ourselves. Because what they don't want is the nationalization of all the food and everything they've worked hard to provide for their communities being given to all the refugees. And what they're afraid of course, is that there'll be stratification of who gets what depending on political affiliations. So if the refugees happen to be, you know, Marxists, that they will get the food. And if you happen to be a capitalist, you won't get the food. So, there is some legitimate concern there of what they're talking about, which is why they want to feel like I can protect my home. We have, a lot of people have caches of food and provisions in case there is a catastrophe. And they've spent hard-earned money and effort to get this. And so the refugees come pouring in. You know, they say, hey, you know, it's my, let me decide who I want to share it with. I don't want the government telling me who I have to share it with, because the government plays favorites. That's what they're afraid of. So that is a legitimate concern. And on the other hand, if it's just out of control, you know, you would want some sort of policing going on. So it's a lose-lose thing, isn't it? Obviously, there isn't a right answer. It's one of those things where there really isn't any right answer. Both sides have strong arguments on that one. Water, everything. You know, if it's just total refugee situation, chaos going on, then, you know, is it just everyone for themselves, or is this the federal government step in with National Guard and all this kind of stuff, and or who is it that has? They want, you know, state National Guard on the local police to take care of it, that kind of thing, which is why they have now made it illegal for local police to have militarized weaponry and equipment, so that they won't be able to handle a refugee situation, because see, local police would give precedence to local people, citizens, right? Say, hey, wait a minute, you know, why should you be thrown into refugee status? So this is what's at stake. Is, you know, you should be able to keep your property in what the provisions you put aside, and you should be able to protect that, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, because that's just independent. You know, you are smart, provident citizen who's been thinking ahead and planning, and that should be rewarded, and you shouldn't have to part ways with that. And so local policing would support that much more than federalization of all this stuff, where they confiscate everything you have in some depot and then pass it out according to preferential politics, probably, because all, you know, everything's politics really here. So, you know, they have a strong case. They have a strong case for that, actually. Oftentimes, refugees, for instance, the East Pakistan refugees in India, they weren't allowed to come into India and just take whatever they wanted. They were settled in refugee camps, where the people in India they were allowed to keep their property and their food and everything like that. So, I think what the struggle is over what to do with refugees. Should they be settled in camps, and then the government help provide food for them, or is everything going to be nationalized, and the refugees are giving equal status to those who are non-refugees, and the forced sharing, for instance, of all goods, etc., like that. This is what's on their mind, what's on everyone's mind at some level. Now, what's on Christians' mind has been his rapture. Which is, you know, that's the ultimate refugee situation, right? Where you choose a different universe. You choose God's final judgment upon you, and from that point, the blessings of the final judgment are upon you. And that's the road you walk upon. Now, if you had, like, provisions, for instance, and there's all these refugees, what would most people say, well, our family comes first, right? And then our relatives and our friends come first. If I'm going to share, I'm going to share with people who have helped provide this, who have supported me. All right, that's just basic human nature. If I have a limited amount to share, don't I have a right to decide who to share it with? That's called self-governance. And the federal government would say, no, you don't. We have the right. But by what authority do they have the right to override self-governance in terms of sharing with family and friends? I mean, this is a question. The Marxists claim they have the right to decide everything for you, especially who you share your providence with and your provisions. Should there be, you know, a crisis, that they have a right to override any considerations of sharing with family and friends, and ultimately they'll insist that the party members get all the goods, whatever they need first, and they have to survive first. You see, that's ultimately what the Marxists always decide on. In times of famine, who gets the food? Party members, Politburo members, members of the party, the Marxist socialist, communist party, they're always the ones who get to cherry pick everything. See, and then individuals say, wait a minute, I want to give to my family and my relatives, my friends, my loved ones. And then the local people, community who've lived with me my whole life and supported me, my friends in the community, I have a right to make that decision. There's a fundamental conflict again between capitalism and Marxism. So I would say the concern about Jade Helm is certainly a huge concern between this, again, this dichotomy between Marxism and capitalism. And it's being highlighted here, very much highlighted. Christians would say, look, my advice is, they might say, I don't have anything, but I do have advice. Accept the final judgment of God upon you right this instant. Repent, in other words, repent. And the kingdom of heaven is yours. And you don't have to worry about scarcity at all, nor do you need to worry about any calamity, nor do you need to worry about any refugee. You're not a refugee in the kingdom of heaven. You're perfect, because you never really left at all. You have everything. So, of course, the Marxist government is trying to confiscate all guns, because that's the only way that they can then cherry pick, you know, nationalize everything and decide, you know, who gets it. And it'll be those who have helped put them in power and help sustaining and keeping them in power. Those are the ones who will get preferential treatment for sure. Absolutely for sure. So it is a nasty situation going on in the United States and around the world right now, really, in various ways. Which is why we, again, have to focus on accepting the good news that of God's final judgment upon us, that we have the authority to insist upon it and be aware of it, completely aware of it, and completely blessed by it. I mean, to accept it completely and to be accept the final judgment upon us. We can have that upon us, come upon us, absolutely. This is all important in this times right now. And this is this third option I've been pointing out for years and years and years. Avail yourself of this third option. There's not many people who get it. They really don't. I don't know if anyone really gets it yet. But this is the answer. Yeah, we'll find out very soon how it plays out. It's interesting, the Pope's been saying how he doesn't think he's going to live very long. He's been saying that ever since he was made Pope. And well, if he's in the United States on September 25th, the East Coast, he might not live very long. Maybe that's what he's getting at, right? Now, again, the information I've received from the Holy Spirit is something that's going to hit us. It has to do with water very unexpectedly, without any warning at all, actually, from official warning at all, without any official warning whatsoever. Now, I don't know when this is going to happen. I certainly feel that it's likely at some point it will happen. I don't have any specific date that I know about. But, you know, at this point, some people use the Jewish celebration dates to figure it out. The blood moon is on, was it the third blood moon is on September 25th. Some people feel it's that. Now, it's interesting. I went out yesterday evening. And it was dusk. It was like about 8:30 at night or so, and walked out in the driveway and I looked up in the sky. I said, "Whoa, what is that? I've never seen anything like it." There were like two stars. Like I said, no, planets. Those are planets. They're lined up, one right in front of the other, almost. Not a perfect alignment, but very close, like a 1 degree separation. And I said, wow, what in the world? What is that? So I went in and, you know, Googled it, and It turns out that it's Venus and Jupiter lined up. Venus and Jupiter lined up. Of course, the planets go, what goes? Sun, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and then what the heck? We can't even see it after that. But there's a Neptune out there, and there's Pluto out there, and some of the outer planets. We don't get to see them, do we? Too far away. They're very far away. So, but we get looks at Jupiter and Venus. Venus is the brightest. Other than the sun and the moon, it's the brightest object in the sky. And so when they're aligned like that, it's quite spectacular. And you can see the alignment of that tonight. It'll be aligned through about July 4th, about a five-day period. It was quite stunning and spectacular. The western sky. It was in the western sky. And the full moon was coming up in the east. And so the sun was hitting the moon, making it full, and hitting these stars also, which is light reflecting off the two planets. Very spectacular. Now, scientists are claiming that this is actually the star of Bethlehem that the three wise men followed to the west. Okay, they came from the east. So this Venus-Saturn conjunction would... Venus-Jupiter conjunction would be seen in the western sky. And so if you were from the east, if you were traveling towards this so-called star of Bethlehem in the sky, this bright light in the sky, from the east, you would be traveling west. So that's what the three wise men, they're astrologers actually, magi astrologers, from the east were seeing a bright star in the sky in the west, traveled in that direction, thinking that was some omen. Now, they're said to arrive sometime after Jesus' birth. We don't know how long after Jesus' birth, actually. It could have been several years, actually. They said there's this conjunction of Venus-Jupiter in about, 2 or 3 B.C. They talk about both maybe 3 and 2 B.C. It would have been there. I don't know why they can't pin it down to one or the other. But and Jesus was born, I believe, in like 5 to 6 B.C., it seems that based on the Herod the Great, etc., all this. So they may have come when Jesus was still an infant. Of course, they said they fled to Egypt, too. So, but the chronology isn't exactly clear. So this could have been the star of Bethlehem. Some say it's a supernova they were following, too, possible. But it wouldn't be surprising if this is the star of Bethlehem that they talked about. And so we're being made aware of the star of Bethlehem now. Has to do with Jesus being in the world. You see, Jesus has to do with Jesus being in the world. Sometime after this fact occurred, and with the birth of Jesus back then, the wise men would have been following the star Bethlehem. This is after Jesus was born. And so I've said Jesus has been back in the world now for 2 months. 2 months. And now we have the star Bethlehem conjunction here, Venus-Jupiter conjunction in the sky. Perhaps that is signaling that Jesus is back in the world. You see? Very interesting. And the benefit of that is we're getting this more direct teaching, this more clear teaching now, actually. It's a huge benefit to us. This is super helpful teaching here on these videos, actually. Once we're able to process it. See, when we're in the wow, we can't process it. It's processing, but it's seeping into us. And we just have to stay quietly there, coast and coast. Don't try to force the processing. That's why I say, don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with the struggle. There's a struggle going on in the processing of this subconsciously. This is taking place. Just let it take place. Don't struggle and try to force it. Keep the intellect and the emotions out of it. Be in neutral. So in church, your priests give the homily. Everyone's quiet. Listen, this is how it needs to go. Somebody needs to be an authority figure, and do the flipping the script assertion thing that helps bring people into the wow condition, the congregation into the wow condition, and then they need to, you know, sit full stop in the wow, and practice this full stop in the wow, and don't talk, you know. Arrive in silence, leave in silence, and be silent in between. It's very, to practice this, it's very important. You don't start raising and ask questions. Hey, you know, priest, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? Hey, let me talk about Marxism. No, the priest will summarize what is important to be said. In other words, the one who is capable of doing this, it's a very unique skill, actually, to be able to do this and not lose the wow yourself. You know, it's very difficult. And you have to be very highly trained to do it. And so just to respect that and have faith in it and say, okay, you know, my job is to stay full stop on the wow and just keep tuning in on that. That's why I don't have any dialogues with people. You know, very minimal interaction at all is part of the training. You just have to know what to mention, and then we can mention what's going on in the world and say, okay, there's no answer there at all. The answer is to accept God's judgment right here and now, and people can say, okay, now I see that, okay. That helps clarify it. I get it. Yeah, neither one is right. That's right. Neither one is right. Neither is a mixture of the two right at all. The independents, the libertarians and all this, neither is that right. None of those political solutions are right. Self-governance is the only way, meaning the governance of the judgment of God. Spiritual governance is the only way. The governance of the judgment of God upon us is true governance. It's the only true governance there is. Everything else is arrogance. And the idea that somehow we can find out through history which of these, Marxism or capitalism or libertarianism or the blending of the two, which of those is right, is ridiculous. None of them are right. They'll never be right. Arrogance will never be right. The judgment of arrogance upon us, it will never be right. It doesn't matter how arrogance decides to govern itself. It doesn't make any difference whatsoever. It's always wrong. It'll always be wrong. It'll never be right. So we don't need to wait to see how history plays out. That's ridiculous. Let's accept God's final judgment upon us right this instant. Let's accept God's final judgment upon us right this instant. Now, if you're wondering, how can I be saying this? Well, that's the result of almost 40 years of intense work with Jesus, following Jesus' teachings. Intense emergency kind of work, a full-on grind constantly. This is the only way that I've been able to get here, to be able to be available at, you know, right now to say this, to be helpful, to get a little bit ahead of the curve here so we have some advance warning. So let us accept the governance of God's final judgment upon us right now. Let's accept that as our governance. Let's accept our governance of God's final judgment upon us right this instant. Let that be our governance. Let that be our governance, plain and simple. So this is the ones who are blessed, who have chosen the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says he's coming back to invite those who have chosen the kingdom of heaven to come dwell with him in the place that he's prepared for us, which would be most likely another universe. Another dimension, another universe. Those who are prepared. He said he's coming back. That's why he's coming back. to invite those who have repented to experience the fruits of repentance. That's all. Those who have repented, absolutely have the right to experience the fruits of repentance right this instant. They don't have to sit around waiting on this farce we call history, this absolute farce we call this universe, history, time, space, process, and form, this dream, this farcical dream. Arrogance trying to figure out how best to govern arrogance. What's the best kind of governments in the kingdom of time? You know, we're trying to figure that out. What other nonsense? There is no kingdom of time, never will be. So how can there be a better system of governance for what has never existed and never will exist? This is sheer lunacy. Now, in my opinion, that the Mass should be lengthened to at least an hour and a half. Because after you take the Eucharist, for instance, in Catholicism, it's a commitment to full stop in the wowness. Shouldn't you have an opportunity to sit there quietly for half an hour to practice it? Now, what they're saying is when you go home, you gotta, you know, can be committed to it. But let's be honest, you're driving, you're at home, and there's so many distractions, you know, it's not the best idea. Why not give us an opportunity to practice it right there? Extend the Mass to an hour and a half. We extend these videos to more than that. You know, we're getting super, this is like high Mass, you know, here. Real high Mass. Nothing wrong with that. We're really, eating the words and teachings of Jesus here, taking them in, chewing upon them, like a cow chewing cud, really considering them, giving great consideration and following the advice of how to practice. So we're maxing out on it, which is what we should do. I'd say that maybe a minimum an hour and a half should be put aside, a minimum. People should go to Mass every day, the true Mass of full stop on the wow of asserting that I insist that the final judgment of God be upon me this very instant. This assertion, this insistence, this should be every day, hour and a half every day, and then maybe on weekends 2.5 hours, something like that, each day 2.5 hours. And this is basic preparation for, you know, just, this is just being provident. This is being truly provident. This is the true providence of Christians. The true providence of Christians at this time is right spiritual practice. It's not getting an armory. Okay, that's not really true providence. Being, you know, prepare for what is to come. Being provident, being wisely provident for what is to come. That's Old Testament. Old Testamentness, which is not really Christianity, is it? It's Mosaic law. That's a patriarchal religion. Religion of the patriarchs is the Old Testament. Jesus brought a New Testament. So the Christians are being truly provident by right spiritual practice. This is the truth. This is the answer. This is how to be truly provident. Because when things get bad, we want to be able to fully accept God's judgment upon us, which means final judgment, God's final judgment, which carries with it all of God's decisions regarding us. You know, whatever it is, that's it. And so then we are able to experience, you know, all the blessings of God, all the providence that God has for us in terms of what's His judgment upon us. And we have perfect faith that it will be the judgment of God upon us will be that we are absolutely perfect, exactly as He created us to be. And with that comes all perfection, all blessings, you see. So the idea of shifting universe is a piece of cake at that point. You know, that's just God's providence for us. That's just God's judgment upon us is all. And we accept it. That's how it's easy. So let all Christians be truly provident, as well as all Buddhists and Hindus and every other religion that wants to be provident in that way, depending on, you know, how they feel about it. But let everyone who feels guided in this direction by the grace of God to practice right practice, right spiritual practice, full stop in the wow, quiet, be still, be quiet. This is the key to it. Be committed to give up all any intention to move about, any intention to talk, any intention to act, any intention to react, any intention to emote, any intention to distract, any intention to goof off. Give up all those intentions. And you say, I'm just going to sit here quietly. Still, quiet, just sit here, that's all. And keep my mind alert. And don't let it struggle with the struggle. Just let me sit in the wow. Let me just coast in the wow, or I'm just coasting. Only thing about this cloud cover, it cools it down during the day, but it may trap the heat during the night, so the night might be really warm. For people without air conditioning, that's going to be quite rough. We're not used to real warm nights here. We usually just open the windows, put on fans, and get the cool air circulating, and that's how we do it. If those who don't have AC. AC is not that common here. It's so temperate that it's not really needed that often. A couple times a year, you know, but if you're going to have a real hot summer, then people are going to be suffering a bit here. I remember though the hottest temperatures here were like 30, 35 years ago or so, or maybe almost 40 years ago. I remember the heat spell we had was just, you know, set records, and haven't even come close to that since then. But again, climate is always changing, there's no question about it. Always changing throughout, look out throughout history. It's just, it never stays still, does it? The idea that somehow we can make the climate stand still is ludicrous. I mean, who knows when an ice age may come? You know, can we stop that? The idea of somehow controlling the climate through technology and science or whatever is a pipe dream. The idea that this planet has a stable climate throughout history is ridiculous. I think there's too many low information people in the world who don't understand that I mean, we had many ice age in Europe, for instance, in the last 2,000 years. There've been brutally cold periods that really caused massive deaths and problems, and took civilization down in the Dark Ages for some extent. We've had severe droughts. I mean, Egypt was decimated by drought. 100-year drought, you know, so was Canaan. The Holy Land was also over many times decimated. Isaac's children fled to Egypt, right? I mean, they had to go down to Egypt to get food. If the famine was so bad in the Holy Land, and then Egypt has suffered from just brutal famines. The Sahara Desert used to be a lush, green forest land, lakes and rivers and stuff. All gone. So there's always radical climate change in this planet, no matter what you do, no matter what you do. This is a very unstable place. That's its nature. It's a dream of arrogance. Arrogance is inherently unstable. There's no way you can stabilize arrogance. It's impossible. That's why I say You know, you're free to try to do what you want to do. But if you're a religious leader, you have to be focusing people on true salvation, which is to accept God's final judgment upon us right this instant, this very instant. That's what you have to be focusing on if you're a religious leader. If you're not a religious leader, then don't be a religious leader. It's that simple. And then don't try to sugarcoat it, the fact you're not a religious leader. Like the Pope's not a religious leader. He's just trying to sugarcoat it. So I'll do good works, do good works. Yeah, I'm a good person. Do work, do good works, do good works. Yeah, that's not a religious leader. A religious leader puts front and center what the agenda is, sets the agenda for the flock right up front, says this is the agenda right here, period. That's the kind of leader that people deserve. That's the kind of authority that we deserve. Someone who just absolutely sets the agenda for us. This is it. No waffling around. Well, we're going to do this also and this and that. No, this is the agenda. This is what you're doing. Full stop in the wow. Accept God's judgment upon us this very instant. I accept God's judgment upon me this final judgment. I accept God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Yes, I have already accepted God's final judgment upon me this very instant. No question, I've already accepted it, and my spirit has already accepted, yes, I already accept God's final judgment upon me this very instant. This is the agenda, that's it. And it's necessary for this agenda to succeed, just to practice sitting quietly. That's it. And the sitting quietly is something we can learn to do. It's a skill. It's a skill. It needs its will. And you need will in order to do it properly. But we absolutely can do it. And this enables us to then the dawning of the great good news that of God's final judgment upon us is like, wow. I'm perfect being. I'm perfect spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm absolutely perfect spirit. Nothing can touch me. I'm sovereign over my own experiencing completely. Therefore, there's no sin. There's no guilt. There's no vulnerability. Nothing can ever happen to me. Wow. Complete sovereign. You know, this is such a big wow. So, must practice. Full stop in the wow as this dawns upon us. So who knows what I'll say next? I don't know. Just have to keep pressing the issue here in this world. It's up to the Holy Spirit. It's up to the Holy Spirit. So we will keep pressing this issue as fast as possible. We don't have a lot of time in this situation. And it's that simple. It's that simple. Okay, so we're going to end this one. We're almost at 2 hours. We've done a great job here, for sure. Great job, as always. And the video hasn't cut.